session of Rendered Meetup. So I'll be presenting the recently introduced concept of coroutines in Kotlin 1.3. So coroutines were around in Kotlin since a while in our early preview mode, but recently they have been introduced into stable APIs. So for those who came a little late, myself Abhishek Bansal, and I've been doing software from past 6 years, particularly Android experience is like 4 years, and I'm currently working as lead Android developer in Dr. Box Health. So let's start. So agenda is like, first we will be talking about what is coroutine, what does coroutine means, what is it all about, then how similar it is and how different it is from threads, then we will be coming to Kotlin particularly and talk about the only language feature which is supporting coroutines in Kotlin is a suspend modifier. And then we'll talk about briefly about coroutine builders and coroutine scope. Then I planned for a short demo. So in the demo, I have converted the project that I created last time, that is MVVM with RxJava. So I have removed RxJava from that and introduced coroutines. So we'll see how clean or how better the code is with coroutines. So coroutines, so first of all, let's follow the tradition and do a little hello world. Yeah, so this is the smallest coroutine program that we can write. So if you, so let's for now just ignore all the jargon that is there. So global scope dot launch, this launches a coroutine. So whatever code is written inside it, it's launched inside a coroutine. There's a delay. So as the name suggests, it will delay the execution for 1 second, and then it will print the word. And if you see, after global scope dot launch, it's printing hello, and then there's a thread dot sleep to keep the JVM alive, to just keep the process alive.
So this is a plain Kotlin program, not an Android.
Yeah. So if you execute this program, it will first come to the print line, right? Then it will print hello, then this delay will complete and it will print word.
Okay.
So coroutines are like threads.
Uh-huh.
Coroutines are like threads, you can just assume this for a while.
Right.
It is safe to assume. So this will be launched in a separate thread, you can say. And this hello will print, this thread will be waiting for 1 second, then word will print, then this sleep will get over and the program will.
So the first thing that will happen is that the coroutine will start waiting.
Yes.
Then the hello will be printed.
Yes.
Okay.
So because here you are starting a new thread, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So the thread is waiting, then hello will print,
mm-hmm.
and then word will print, so it will print hello word.
Okay.
So
but if you don't write the last thread or sleep?
Then the program will exit and nothing, just the hello will print.
The word will not print.
Word will not print because the process is not there.
So the even though there's a coroutine running there, it'll not block the main overall program from exiting.
So coroutines are scope, right? So this global scope is the process scope.
Mm-hmm.
So when the process, the scope itself is not there, coroutine will not run.
Okay.
Right, so what are coroutines? The concept called coroutines is not new. It was introduced in like 1958 for the first time, when the programming languages even did not exist.
Yeah.
Right. And it was first formally published in 1962. So Melvin Conway is the guy who coined the term coroutine. So as per Wikipedia, it's a little jargon. Coroutines are computer program components that generalize some routines for non-preemptive multitasking by allowing multiple entry points for suspending and resuming execution at certain locations. So let's break it down a little bit. So coroutines are computer program components, that is self-explanatory. Then that generalize subroutines. So subroutines are nothing but your general methods. So it's like general Java method or Kotlin method or any language's function or method for that matter. So coroutine generalize those functions for non-preemptive multitasking. What is meant by non-preemptive multitasking is, so let's get into the operating systems for a while. So there are two types of multitasking scheduling, that is preemptive and non-preemptive. So preemptive scheduling is where we use some algorithm to schedule threads and processes on the CPU. Like we have heard round robin algorithm, FIFO, or last in first out and things like that. Non-preemptive multitasking is where programmer is responsible to schedule the task, like what task should execute when. So coroutines are a form of non-preemptive multitasking by allowing multiple entry points for suspending and resuming execution at certain locations. So how it is done is, so coroutines are methods which can suspend before the execution of their completes. So in general programming, what happens is, suppose you call a function which has four lines. So after that four line complete, then only the program will come to the next line. But this is not something happens with coroutine. In coroutine, that function can suspend itself after two lines, and it can maintain that state. It can get the flow back to the caller. Caller can do some work, and then caller can again get back to that function which was already executed till second line, and it will now start execution after third line. So this is little complex. We will see this concept in detail later. So, but this is how the coroutine work. Yeah. So coroutine are another way of writing non-blocking asynchronous code. So thread is one, then coroutine is second, and coroutines are like threads. So there is some confusion, but we'll clear that confusion in a while. So coroutine provide concurrency, like the thread provides. So you can have like two tasks running at the same time with coroutine. The third line is the same, which I just explained, that a function can suspend and return back to the caller, then caller then finishes work and then return back to the caller function again.
So this is just like, basically similar to the threads of like wait and notify stuff.
Yes.
But it's by default they
yes.
Done this stuff.
Yeah. But with threads it's pretty expensive.
It's pretty expensive, but a bit complicated also.
Yeah.
It generally leads to certain problems at the end of the day.
You mean race conditions?
Huh?
You mean race conditions?
Yeah, race conditions and other issues also, other concurrence services that will produce like a concurrency nightmare if you do this stuff. Like if you start waiting a jump of threads, suspend jump of bunch of threads, and then start a new thread. This is a horrible way to do stuff, that if you have to do some asynchronous stuff,
mm-hmm.
if you have to mimic this by threads.
Yeah.
But yeah, like theoretically you could do. But you mean to say that here it's safe to do this kind of stuff that you
Yeah, because programmer is responsible for scheduling the task. So you will be never doing, you will be never scheduling another thread in your critical section.
Right.
So the race condition will never arrive. So no synchronization needed, no context switches are needed.
Yes.
So they are very, very, very lightweight. So coroutine and threads. So if you speak loosely, coroutines are like very lightweight threads, like I said. If you see at this code sample, what it's essentially doing is launching like 100,000 coroutines at the same time. Try doing that with threads.
Stack overflow.
Out of memory exception, because each thread has their own stack space, which takes about like 2 MB of memory, and 100,000 threads is, I don't know, 20 terabytes of memory. Because 10,000 thread is like 20 GB already.
Mm-hmm.
So you cannot do this with thread. You cannot even imagine. But coroutine, it's simple. So this dot will be printed immediately after 1 second. 100,000 dots will be there on your screen.
So coroutines are not using threads.
They might or might not.
Okay.
Depending upon the implementation in the language.
And what about using multiple processors at the same time? What do you use?
So yeah, so you can use four threads and use coroutines inside them, right?
Okay. But if I, let's say, wanted to, I have an 8-core CPU and I launch 8-core routines, will not be running on 8 different cores?
That again depends. So there are different coroutine builders which will run coroutines on different threads if you want.
Okay.
So obviously you would want to use your hardware if it's there, but you want to use it as efficient as possible. Coroutine and thread. So conceptually, coroutines are not thread at all. Coroutines are not thread. Coroutines are just functions which can suspend and return the flow back to the caller. So this is one important difference between coroutines and threads. Coroutines provide concurrency but not parallelism. So what is meant by that? So suppose you have a single core processor and you launch 4 different threads on it. So that is concurrency. Your 4 threads will be running at the same time, but they will not be running parallel on 4 different cores because 4 different cores are not even available. So they will be utilizing CPU time one by one in some with help of some algorithm. It can be round robin, it can be P4 or whatever it is. So the CPU time is sliced in typically in 100 milliseconds and each thread comes and use that CPU, then next thread comes and things like that. So that is concurrency, but that is not parallelism. So coroutines are providing you concurrency but not parallelism like thread 2. Scheduling is non-preemptive and is done by language and programmer. So scheduling is done by programmer itself, like when a coroutine should suspend, when it should resume, it's the responsibility of programmer and the language. So it's super efficient because there is no context switching. There is no actual thread switching on the CPU. So this is efficient. So there is no extra stack space, like I said, like launching 100,000 threads was not possible. And no synchronization is needed because obviously you'll not be switching the coroutine in your critical space. And one more important difference is threads are always global. Threads are not scoped, but coroutines are scoped. Coroutines have their own life cycle and scope in which they can exist.
So I would use coroutines for something like blocking IO, but I would not use it for something like running calculations in parallel.
You might even update your UI in 4 different coroutines.
Okay.
Asynchronously.
I don't understand this scoped and.
We'll come to it in detail.
When you say that not parallel, but you are saying it's running together. The context is not happening if they're not running, so how it happening?
So suppose this is your CPU, right? And you have launched like thread 1, thread 2. So it's a single core CPU. Mm-hmm. So what will be happening in the case is there's algorithm like how OS will schedule. So it's OS responsibility to give both of them CPU time. Right? So if signals threaded CPU, what will happen is thread 1 will come and suppose we are slicing CPU time in 100 milliseconds. 100 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds. So we have like 500 milliseconds of CPU time and both of this thread takes like 200 milliseconds to complete and this thread takes like 300 milliseconds. So there will be context switching. So thread 1 will come, it will run for 100 milliseconds, then depending on what algorithm, it's just an example, then thread 2 will come, then thread 1 will again come. But thread 1 is completed in 200 milliseconds, so thread 2 will take rest of the time.
So that is a common thread. What happens in coroutine?
In coroutine, there is only single thread. There is only single thread and the single thread will be taking 500 milliseconds of this CPU and as a programmer I am deciding like which thread is running mine. So in the few slides it will be more clear like how this CPU is happening.
Yeah.
So this T1, T2, this is expensive which we are saving. Also we are saving this stack space.
If I summarize what you are saying is, like the season of doing this, this is non-preemptive fiddling.
Yeah.
So we are taking care of like, so ultimately it will also not happen in parallel. No, parallel not happening,
yeah.
But we are controlling that which context switching is controlled by us basically.
Yes.
Context will happen because there will be like, if there are four coroutines, we are managing them, like this will run now, this will
but
run.
It's not actual physical context switching, it's not like switching to threads.
Fair enough, whatever.
Yeah.
So whatever.
Switching to threads on the CPU is
expensive. Okay.
So the suspend modifier is the Kotlin languages function, feature. So Kotlin provides this modifier to mark methods which can suspend. Right. So it allows a method to be launched in a coroutine. So in a coroutine, only methods marked with suspend can be used. And a suspend method can only call suspend methods. Right. So method mark is suspend can only be called from a coroutine or a method mark as suspend. There's a good example that I found on this blog. Let's see that. So what he is trying to do, he is trying to fill these three progress bars simultaneously, concurrently. Right? So let's see the code. So what he is doing is there is a race which is happening between these three progress bars. There is a race that is happening between the three progress bar, and whenever one wins, the program ends. Okay. So let's see how it is being done. Yeah. So there is a suspend function called start running. And what it does is it gives a delay and it adds a progress bar progress by a random number. Right? There is a delay. This is not thread.sleep. This has to be noted. This is a coroutine delay. So I'll tell you what it does. So while this delay is being happening, and one more function can execute. If it was thread.sleep, this thread would have been blocked. But what this delay does is, it's a special delay function. It will not block the thread. It's called non-blocking delay. It will not block the thread. Rather, it will return that thread to thread pool, and that thread can meanwhile execute some other code. So what this allows us to do is, that allows us to launch these three coroutines simultaneously in the UI thread itself. We could not have done this using normal threads because we cannot update UI on another thread. So launch Android, this is a coroutine builder. So usually this launch will launch a coroutine in a separate thread. But here, since we have provided Android context, so it will launch this coroutine in the UI thread itself. And this, all of these three coroutines will run concurrently on the UI thread, and every progress bar will keep on updating by a random number, and as soon as race ends, right, the program, it just shows a test, just shows a toast and exits, and this is the result. So is there anything that is not clear? If you want to take a look at this code.
If you remove delay one time, what will happen in this program?
Huh?
If you remove delay, then what happens?
If we remove delay, then there is no time for other coroutine to execute.
So only like whatever the first thing you start, only that progress are filled up. Then
yeah.
The second, then the third.
Yes. So if it was a normal function, it would have been blocked there.
If it's a normal function?
It would have been blocked there. If it was thread.sleep,
yeah,
then it would have been blocked there. That delay allows thread to do other things. So this function suspends here at this delay.
With the state.
Yeah, with the state. And the
same
any
code
other
can be used by the other basically.
Sorry?
Basically same code is being used, but the previous state has been same.
Yes.
With the caller.
Yes.
And when at the 11th millisecond when it wakes up, it just wakes up from this state only.
Yes. And whenever the thread is available, it starts executing.
So it is the same thread only.
But yeah,
yes.
Then also
It's the same thread. It's concurrent running, it's not parallel. So that. Otherwise, we cannot update UI on the main thread.
One question.
Yes.
You have got three launch
yes.
methods. Means you have launched three coroutines.
Yes.
Right. And you have added delay. So it means every coroutine is added, then it's waiting for 10, and then again another coroutine invoke, and they it is start working, then it wait for a 10, and then another means three threads, three coroutines working in that way.
Yes. Concurrently.
This is the
yes. You have a question? Let's get back to the presentation.
So at one time only one coroutine is running actually.
Yes.
Obviously the others are at delay. So once the delay has been woke up, it just starts the execution.
Yes.
Until the next delay, and then just passes on the basically control to whatever the next two coroutines are whosoever is waiting basically. Right.
So whatever coroutine is currently in awake state, it will start executing
till the delay will be called.
Yes.
Okay.
One more thing, each coroutine is running on one thread.
No. So all three are running on the same thread.
Same thread.
That is UI thread.
You haven't defined like you want three or four. So the moment you say launch, in fact, what would you understand that now four are launched, so I have to call four to one. Because the earlier example you showed 10,000, you are creating something like
that.
But here you are not creating anything like that. So here you are saying the moment you say launch, it automatically talk to each other and understand each other's.
Yeah. So it's the Kotlin's responsibility to schedule. So here we were saying repeat 100,000 and launch. So it will launch in 100,000 times. It's a loop. It's a loop.
It's a loop.
Coroutine builders. So coroutine builders are not something which is available in Kotlin language, but they are available as a library from the JetBrains. So Kotlin has this philosophy of keeping the language API very clean, very concise, very small, and they delegate most of the work to the libraries and extension functions. So JetBrains is very aggressively developing this helper library for coroutines. The coroutine builders are part of it. Coroutine builders are essentially functions which take lambdas as argument with suspend modifiers. So as I told previously that a suspended function can only be launched from a suspend function, right? But what if we want to launch a coroutine from our normal code, a method which is not marked with suspend? So we use these coroutine builders because we can pass our code to them and that lambda is marked as suspend. So can be invoked from regular non-suspending functions, and this is kotlinx.coroutines, it's by JetBrains, it's an open source development. So there are a few examples of these coroutine builders. First is MUM.
In the last example, which you just drafted, you show the lambda, so the lambda was there.
Sorry?
You show the suspending lambda in that actually. That is
that. Yeah. So This is lambda in Kotlin.
So if there's only one parameter which is a lambda, then you can pass it like this in Kotlin.
So in this, if this is the same function, right? Start running. So if we had three suspended functions, and the delay would have been different for those things, then how will it queue those functions?
That scheduling, how exactly will happen, that I cannot predict. But
so right now, like it will run in a queue, first the green, then the red, then the blue.
No, it's not like that. Well, the first, obviously, the green will start running, then it's delayed. By
yeah.
the time these, both of them are queued.
Yeah, so.
And any one of them can start them.
So in that delay, this red will work, right? This red job will execute.
That, I'm not sure about that. I think any of them can start.
So in this result, basically, green is actually getting filled up now. So it is not like red would come up or blue would fill, like a particular example. I never saw
only
one
red video.
I think it's a yeah, maybe.
That's no, so, so what can happen?
Yeah.
I will tell you. So what can happen here?
Yeah.
green is launching first, so it has like advantage. That I agree. But what can happen here? Green can have ones all the time, while red can have tens. So it can also win. Anyone can win here. It's not deterministic. And also you could use different seeds. Maybe you can generate a random seed to make it more fair, but that's not the point.
So perhaps the delay is really creating the whole runs.
Yeah.
So can this happen that only two coroutines are working and the third one is never called? Like you don't know how it is scheduled, right?
Mm-hmm.
We cannot predict that.
Mm-hmm.
So there are three coroutines.
Mm-hmm.
So can it happen that only two coroutines are called and the third one is never scheduled?
How that will happen? That delay is not non-blocking delay. It will not block the thread. It will only block that particular coroutine.
Yeah. So we have three coroutines.
So what happens is the first coroutine runs. It runs immediately and then
it is delayed
for 10 seconds, right? Immediately the second one runs.
Yeah.
That's also delayed for 10 seconds.
No, so because the three ones have the same delay here, right?
Uh-huh.
What if they have different delays?
So if you are putting infinite delay on one, then that will obviously not work.
Not infinite. Like suppose somehow this use case is there that the first one is completed
like
before second.
Take one example.
So suppose right now we have three coroutines.
Mm-hmm.
The first one has like suppose 1 second.
1 second delay. Yes.
Okay, the second and third one is fine. So
they have how much delay?
Maybe 10. I'm not 10 sure.
10 second delay each. Okay.
Yeah. So the first one is run. It will wait for 1 second.
Then
so in that delay, second one will run, right?
No, it will not run because you have put the delay of 10 seconds there.
Okay, I think I'll give a better example for this question. So in the first thread, you have a delay of, let's say, 1 millisecond.
Hmm.
And in the second coroutine, it does some processing which takes 2 milliseconds.
Yeah.
Hmm.
So by the time the second coroutine comes to the delay, the first coroutine's delay is over.
Hmm.
And the third coroutine is also in the queue.
Mm-hmm.
So which one will run? First one or the third one?
I think the process, when it's inside the processing, it will not switch. It will only switch at the suspension points.
Yeah,
so
by
two
the time it reaches delay,
so two
there are now two coroutines waiting. Mm-hmm. So which one will run? Who decides that?
So 2 millisecond one is still running, right?
Yeah, but then it came to delay. Huh. After that there was a...
So then any of the waiting coroutine will switch.
So is it non-deterministic?
That I am not sure actually.
I'll
have to look.
Okay. So then it might happen that the first one
runs again
and then
third one. Whole paradigm of threading
uh-huh.
in mind that we have created
yeah.
so in so many years.
It's a little
that's
little
why
little
it's
little
difficult little. To understand.
Okay, so example of coroutine builders are like launch. Launch executes a coroutine and returns a job object. So job is an inbuilt type which is cancelable, so that you can cancel coroutine anytime if you want. And then there is async. So async executes a coroutine and it's actually able to return the result back. So it will return deferred. It will return the result wrapped in a future. The future here it is called as deferred. And T is the return type. So if you want T back, then you can use await. Await is a function in Kotlin and not keyword like C sharp or JavaScript. And run blocking is a coroutine builder which blocks the current thread till the coroutine completes, if that is needed at any time. Coroutine is scoped. So coroutines are unlike threads, they are scoped. They have their own life cycle. They are not global. So scope can be global, like there's a class called global scope in coroutine extensions. So if you want to launch your coroutine in the application scope, then you can use global scope. Otherwise, there is a coroutine scope, which is a local scope. So whenever you want to create a local scoped coroutine, then you can use coroutine scope. So having well-defined scope and lifecycle in coroutines, that brings structure to our concurrency. So with threads, that structure wasn't possible because they don't have any scope. They all run in the same application scope. So let's go to the demo. I think time is also over.
Okay.
can have a 5 minute demo.
So typically, the traditional example of async task failing is like there's activity and then from there you do some background task in async task and then you destroy the activity by a bag or something like that and it returns and then it tries to reference the view and it crashes.
Yes.
So typically, if you use coroutine instead of async task and it's properly scoped with
yes.
the activity, then that problem will never arise in the first place because it will be scoped so it will be destroyed, swapped out of the.
Correct.
Right?
Correct. So this is a small demo that I had used in my last talk as well. So it was it's a small example of just a login activity in which I can log in using my credential and if the credentials are wrong then it will throw me an error.
Right.
So let's just dive into the code. So I had created a mock server for this. So in this my mock API service, I have a suspended function login because I want to do networking asynchronously. I want to simulate networking as asynchronously. So I have marked this function as login, and So in this, I am just simulating a delay and returning the login response. So if my credential match, then I am returning a success response. Otherwise, it's an error response. So this service is called from the view model. So in view model, there is how actual coroutine that is being used. So in view model, I am launching a coroutine using global scope.launch and doing this perform login API call and getting the error like I would do in my regular code. Like so by looking at this code, you cannot say if it's asynchronous because there are no callbacks, there are no method chains. This is the beauty of coroutine syntax. So after this demo, I will just show you like what was the previous code and how it is now, so that you will be able to better appreciate the beauty of this code. So if this is an error, then I will say error. Otherwise, I will just post value. So in live data, there are two methods by which you can update the value. One is when you can just set it like using equals, and another is post. So post is used when you are updating the value from a non-UI thread. Because in Android, network is not allowed on UI thread, right? So this launch will spawn, launches a coroutine builder again, which will launch the coroutine in a separate thread. So this perform login API will happen and a result will come and then it is posted to the activity.
So by default it launches in a separate thread.
Yes. So if I pass context here, which is available, I think it's dispatchers.main.
So like does it create a new thread every time a call launches?
Yes, it uses a thread pool internally actually. So if I pass this dispatchers.main, it is again in Kotlin extensions, then it will run on the UI thread. Right. So let me quickly show you what happens here. I'll just put right credentials and see this is the delay that we have simulated. And API response comes and this just logs in. So yeah, so let's go to the difference which is there. So you see this is my view model. This was the code when I was using RxJava.
Can you zoom in? One plus.
This was the code when I was using RxJava and I have always thought that RxJava code is beautiful. And now you see this code.
But then if you want to do something with the response,
So we are pausing this response to UI.
No, passing it to UI is fine, but in RxJava you can do all these like filters and all those things.
Kotlin you can do that anyway without RxJava.
So like the model that I get from the API response.
You can do map, filter, and there are other operators that are readily available. Only if you want to do some complex things like windowing and things like that, then RxJava is. I'm not saying that RxJava needs to be replaced with coroutines. It's just for this use case.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
So here it reads just like a imperative code.
Yes, that is how it is designed in Kotlin.
But then, how would I know that at this point this code might?
So ID will give you an indication that this is a suspension point.
Okay.
I'm not sure if I understood the EI cases here.
Uh-huh.
This means this is suspension point. So the program can suspend here.
Okay. Or. So without IDE, but I would not know that. Does that mean it's not important anymore?
No. So this is a design decision that Kotlin developers have taken.
Uh-huh.
They are saying that so these days most of the time what we are doing is we are downloading data and waiting for it.
Yeah.
There is not much computation happening.
Mm-hmm.
So so they have designed coroutines to suspend by default.
Mm-hmm.
Like for what you say. Which style of programming is when we write
imperative.
Imperative programming. Yeah, so they have designed them for imperative programming by default. And then when you want concurrency, it is concurrency is obvious. Like concurrency is explicit type. Sorry.
Okay.
So global scope dot launch. I'm explicitly saying that launch this inside a new thread.
Uh-huh.
And that suspension function comes here, this perform login. This perform login is just a extension method on the scope.
Okay.
And this
and
I
this
need to write.
Async.await. Okay, so that's where you're doing the await.
Yes.
Okay.
So this is calling this asynchronously and await returns the result.
Uh-huh.
And like if you use retrofit for a networking, retrofit has now a coroutine call factory available by jQuery.
So await is similar to delay, but instead of waiting for a fixed amount of time, you're waiting till you get the response.
Yes. And you can also perform operations like join on coroutine.
Okay.
There is join.
I like to do a thread dog.
Yeah.
Oh.
Okay. Similar to that. So that is it. So.
So basically, if I have to merge data from three different API calls, then say there's already join sort of facility where
yes.
Till the last comes, the two will await, and then third will be
yeah.
Join and push the data.
Yes.
So we have to.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so the API is very, very expensive. So I did not realize this when I took this topic for the talk. And what I've shown is just the tip of the iceberg. It's very vast if you dive deep into it. So there are communication methods between coroutines. There are things like channels using which you can communicate between different coroutines. And yeah. So there are some good talks. So these are some good talks. They are by Kotlin designer itself. So if you want to deep dive in coroutine, then you can go ahead.
Will you be sharing these slides somewhere?
So these slides are already there on GitHub.
Okay, and we'll also be emailing these slides to link to these slides to everybody, so you can get it on there.
So you can find the project code. So if you have any questions. And if you want to send any feedback, just please.
Can you go back to the GitHub and the previous one.
And if anybody needs to contact you or ask you for any questions, what's the best way to reach you?
Email me, please. Thank you, guys.
So if anybody has any questions regarding or wants to discuss more about coroutines, you can do that, take this offline after the last talk. Thank you, Abhishek.
Thank you.
Thank you.